Hello and welcome to the Saxo Bank Trading Floor and this special presentation outlining our outrageous predictions of 2014. I'm Owen Thomas. Over the next half hour or so, we're going to present some scenarios to you that may seem a little ludicrous now, but when you delve deeper down, they contain elements of truth that none of us can afford to ignore. With us throughout the whole programme is Steen Jakobsen, Saxo's Chief Economist and Chief Investment Officer. You've been doing Saxo's outrageous predictions for the past 10 years. So, Chief, happy anniversary. You're keen to stress that these aren't meant to be a pessimistic outlook, right?
Well, first of all, it's not our official view for next year, but it is the test of your portfolio, our client's portfolio, anyone that reads the outrageous prediction. Can your portfolio withstand any of these 10 or all of them all together? Probably if you can withstand all of them, you should put on some more risk. But having said that, it is all about pushing back. And I will make it very, very clear. It's not about the objective if we say dollar yen goes to 80 or 90. It's really about the process and the rationale behind it that drives it. So it's a strategy document that needs to be used for discussion.
Okay, so we're going to hear from Saxo Bank's strategy team. That's the heads of Forex, commodities, macro and equities. But first, to Mr. Jakobsen himself, 2014, he says, could be and should be the year in which a mandate for change not only becomes necessary, but is also implemented. And watch out for some major electoral shifts, perhaps.
Here's one of my outrageous predictions. Next year, we have a very important European parliamentary election. It happens between the 22nd and the 25th of May. It could be the game changer for all of 2014 for you as an investor and you as a private individual. What is going on right now is that in a lot of countries, the anti-EU vote is very strong. In the UK, UKIP is polling above 30% of all the votes. In France, the Front National with Le Pen is leading. In Holland and Netherlands, they are the right-wing parties is strongly represented in the polls as well. So what we are predicting is that as we come through this election in May, we may have the biggest fraction of the European Parliament actually being an anti-EU vote. And this happened at a time where the EU Commission Chairman Barroso is out saying that the problem with Europe is not that we have too much Europe, but that we have too little Europe. We think the voters in Europe will disagree on that statement and will roll back and try to roll back what happens, with huge ramifications for not only the investable markets, but also the EU individual. But everything equal, we think it's good news.
Steen, when you certainly look at UKIP's rise in the United Kingdom, actually, this might not seem so far-fetched.
No, the UKIP right now is polling to be the second biggest party ahead of the Tory party. Clearly in France, the anti-EU vote is even rising with Le Pen. And recently, of course, in Netherlands and across Europe, we've seen that the anti-EU vote is coming through very strong. I don't necessarily think it's an anti-EU vote, but I think it's an anti-too much Euro vote. And it will really upset the politicians.
Well, react how, do you think, in this particular scenario?
They will probably have to go to one of the key features I've been talking about all year, the SME sector. They will have to find real traction in terms of creating jobs. And they will probably put on a standstill a lot of the new ideas and just trying to fulfill some of the obligation they have, for instance, in the financial examination. Don't forget France, as one country, is already in clear violation of the rules. Whether that
it always has been France, isn't it?
No, France has been a part of the core and it's been the periphery who's been the problem. But I think, and that's also what the vote is about, the core of Europe is under attack. And as the wind goes out of the tailwind that the Europe has had for a long time, all of a sudden reality strikes and we need to deal with it both politically, but certainly as we've done all along economically.
It's important to consider this scenario. Why?
Because 22nd, 24th of May is an event risk for you as a trader, as an investor. But it could also be the point from which we change the attitude towards Europe. We will try to find a lower low in terms of what we can agree on in Europe. And in itself, that would be strong. On the other hand, if the EU pushes back, as Barroso has done, wanting more Europe, I think it's going to the breaking point.
And you trade this how? Be long German bonds, I would have thought.
You will buy the core and you will sell the periphery. I in particular will say you have to be long the bonds against the Spanish bono.
Well, Steen will be with us through the whole programme, but we're going to turn our attention now to Forex and more devaluations for the fragile five. John Hardy.
So another of our outrageous predictions for 2014 is that the fragile five, the emerging market countries, Brazil, India, Indonesia, Turkey, and South Africa, that these large emerging market countries and their currencies could devalue by as much as 25% against the US dollar. We saw a bit of a dress rehearsal of this in 2013 when the Fed merely threatened to taper, and if we get the real deal, a real taper in 2014, these currencies are going to tumble. They've got large current account deficits that have developed over time, and as well, most of them are running rather large and scary fiscal deficits as well. And when we have a Fed taper, pressure on global liquidity, they're not getting the funding they need to finance these twin deficits. And the only adjustment we can see to bring things back into balance, to bring exports back up and consumption back down, is through the good old-fashioned currency devaluation. And I think that's a big risk in 2014 for these economies and these currencies.
Well, we've already had an example of this back in the summer, John, with those tapering hints. It could happen again?
Yeah, I mean, we saw quite a reaction in the market, to say the least, across emerging markets when the late May sort of warning that this taper is coming was issued by Bernanke. Across the board, seeing emerging market currencies weaker, the fear being this is a pinch on global liquidity. These countries have gone into current account deficits from strong surpluses. Big pressure on worldwide liquidity and therefore on these currencies.
It's all about the structural changes, though, that need to be happening. You've been talking about this for so long, Steve.
Yeah, we have to see the emerging countries go for what I call a change from nominal growth to quality growth, which means they will accept a far lower actual number for the growth, which means that into the rest of the world there's less demand and growth for us as well. So we're in a negative spin, which actually is going to increase the pressure in these countries because they have to balance something they can't balance.
Well, flows are obviously very important. It's not that outrageous to think that those flows will just dry up totally.
Well, they really caught a break because we had this the non-taper, of course, in September that happened, but we are going to get a real taper. And, of course, the scenario around a 25% devaluation potential has to do with the Fed that is really unwinding the full amount of QE. And with this funding drying up, you've also got the issue of hundreds of billions of dollars that corporates around the world have been borrowing when funding was so cheap and so available. And the assumption was the dollar could only go weaker, and it's extremely cheap to borrow in dollars. Suddenly, you're getting the need to hedge these exposures to the dollar as liquidity is drying up, and that could sort of aggravate the cycle, if you will. This is kind of similar to what happened in the mid-2000s when you had Central and Eastern European house buyers financing their mortgages in Swiss francs. The assumption was this is a great idea, funding is easy, cheap, there's no currency risk. Well, there is a currency risk at some point when these flows possibly reverse.
Well, how do you position yourself then against these scenarios? Some trading ideas, if you would.
Well, you can be short a basket of these currencies. I think a couple of particular weak spots, if this cycle gets particularly aggravated, could be the Turkish lira, because of the need, a tremendous current account adjustment need there, and as well South Africa looks like a weakling. Another interesting aspect here is all of these countries face elections. So I think the sort of the will in 2014, so the will to sort of, at least from the government side, to make some harsh changes that could act as an impact on growth, are not very likely to be seen.
Well, we've got elections in India, in May, Indonesia in July. Is kind of time sort of run out? When you look towards 2014, you look at some of these countries, do you despair, gentlemen?
No, I think it's finally, I would say, finally we're getting to this point where we will probably have the voters for the first time actually not vote with their wallet, but with their real opinion and vision for what needs to be done. And I think I've just been to around 30 countries, and it's nowhere where people see anything in terms of improvement. They all want to change the political guard. They all wanted to get to a different place. And, you know, by irony, the economic conditions of pretended extent will allow them to do this vote and actually carry through this. So for Indonesia, for Brazil, for all these countries, it will be almost godsend that they get this weakness, because they will be forced into doing something in an election year that otherwise would have just been a lost cause for change.
Last thought?
Well, I think we shouldn't see this as we've underlined in a couple other places, this is a pessimistic thing. I think these could be some great investment opportunities in these countries. They have low debt loads, they're demographically positioned quite well in most cases. So this is a great opportunity that they get their structures, the structural situation balanced out. These are wonderful places to invest in.
Okay, John, for now, thank you very much indeed. Well, inflation is a problem for some emerging market countries. Imagine a world where deflation stalks the United States. Mads Kerfoot has.
One of my outrageous predictions for 2014 is that the US will again experience deflation, and this will send the US 10-year Treasury down to 1.5%. Since the Great Recession ended in the US, the US has been muddling through, not really getting any traction. We have seen housing starts plummet whenever mortgage rates rise. We have seen Congress continue to meddle with the US economy. And we see an ongoing private sector deleveraging. All of these point to the US returning to not more inflation, but rather deflation in 2014.
Well, Mads is here, and Mads, you certainly can't overestimate the ability of the Congress and the America's politicians to screw up everything again, frankly.
Exactly, and that is one of the key reasons why we could see the US go into deflation in 2014. We already saw them screw up in 2013, and it could happen again, but there are also other reasons. We have a housing market that could suffer a relapse, and also we have slower global growth, which will hit commodities and then in turn US inflation.
Well, how fragile do you think the housing market is at the moment? I mean, everybody expects the housing market, the price rises too slow for sure in 2014, but actually there is an ability there for those prices to come right down and start falling again.
Indeed, and we already saw it in the spring of 2013 when the Fed started to talk about tapering. We saw the 30-year fixed rate for mortgage just jump more than 1 percentage point, and that in turn hurt new housing sales, which actually dropped to a 1-year low. And we could see another scenario of this type when the next round of tapering talk begins. So housing market is definitely one of the big triggers for potential deflation in 2014.
Steen, do you want to come in here about your outrageous predictions, saying again that these aren't our official predictions about what's going to happen, but you've got to consider these scenarios?
Absolutely, and deflation will be a new buzzword for any macro theme and any video you need to do next year, Owen. That and inequality, in my opinion, are two sides of the same coin where we need to discuss. And deflation is the force in the world right now, because although Asia still have a little bit of inflation, it's coming down. And in Europe, we have, due to demographics, due to the excess capacity, the high unemployment rate, the system is simply full of inability to create final demand. Without final demand, you don't have wage demands, and wage demands is the only thing at the end of the day drive inflation. And I don't see inflation, maybe Mads can see, but I don't see inflation through the wages come through anywhere.
Well, Steen, you mentioned their excess capacity. That is something we've all got to consider.
Exactly, and even though we are seeing the US employment picture improve somewhat, we are still seeing only very mild nominal wage growth. And therefore, also from this part of the economy, there's not enough pressure on prices to rise substantially. So there are plenty of reasons. And it's not only emerging markets slowdown, it's not only the housing markets, it's a lot of things that could end with US falling into deflation.
To trade this scenario, propose what? Going long the 10-year Treasury, yeah?
That is the easy call, and you could do it, for example, directly through the future or also through an ETF, for example, the IEF ETF, which is a mix of 7 to 10-year U.S. Treasuries. You could use that as well. But yeah, we could see the U.S. 10-year go to 1.5 in 2014.
Okay, Mads, for now, thank you very much. If it's all going south in the United States of America, imagine what that would do to the price of oil. Ola Hansen's outrageous prediction.
We have a prediction for Brent crude to reach as low as $80 during 2014. It is outrageous because we've seen an average price for the past 3 years closer to $110. The reason behind it is really that the non-OPEC production continues to rise, but with the recent events in Iran and also with the Libyan oil continuing to be away from the market, if these two starts to flow back in, it's more than 2 million barrels of oil that's going to hit the market. That will require a response from some of the producers. Saudi Arabia will have to cut their production fairly quickly. If they fail to do that, there could be an overreaction in the market and we could reach as low as 80 before we probably see a strong bounce again.
Well, Ola, can you just flesh this out for us? I mean, we've got non-OPEC supply shooting up, Libya's back, Iran's back, a glut of oil.
Absolutely. And the big question is obviously how is OPEC going to react to this? And the reason for this call is basically there's so much oil coming into the market at the same time where we're seeing demand or supply rising very strongly from non-OPEC countries. So really, will OPEC manage to stop this big rise?
Well, could it potentially? I mean, how much power does OPEC have at the moment? Saudi Arabia, of course.
Well, they are probably seeing their power diminishing as years goes by now because, as I said, non-OPEC supply is rising quite dramatically. But, I mean, Saudi Arabia still holds the big key. But obviously, if all this comes together at the same time, we do have an issue because we could potentially look at something like 3 million barrels that Saudi has to cut.
Well, the trading aspect here is fascinating. If we were to see this sort of scenario, because hedge funds would build up major short positions for, what, the first time in years?
Absolutely, but I think the more important point is that Ole's calls on a lower oil is actually critically what we need in the economy right now. Because if you think, which we have to expect, nothing will happen in 24 politically, if you at a bare minimum could get the energy costs down, that impact translates directly into the pocket of the individual, of the SMEs, of the big companies. So we could actually have a massive improvement from this. So although it's on the outrageous call for the price direction and the moves, is size of the move, I think it's actually very, very good for the economy. And I think that is what people need to keep an eye on. And I think Ole and I agree that oil is, generally energy prices, under pressure, at least from the source over the next couple of years.
Do you think, Ole, that producers really would cut production to help this out if we were starting to see this sort of scenario?
Well, OPEC has a history of being better to manage rising prices than falling prices. And because obviously at the moment we know since the Arab Spring that they all need much higher oil prices to balance their budgets.
But we're talking about 100 to 110,
well,
yeah?
Probably, I mean, it depends which country you look at, yeah. But at least above $90 at the moment. And at the same time you have another big producer like Russia who's probably needs close to $110. So obviously it does trigger some interesting reactions across the world if we should get to this point.
Can I just say to everybody that Ole Hansen's outrageous prediction for gold last year did come true? Just recap what that was. You said when really against the grain, gold was going to hit what, 1260?
1200.
1200, yeah. And it did in June, I think.
Yes, we reached the low of 1180, and obviously we're still hovering just above that level.
It may not be so outrageous after all. Ole, for now, thank you very much. We are very near Christmas. Watch out for the hangover in the new year. Maybe. Peter Garnery.
My outrageous predictions is about the US technology sector, which is actually priced quite favorable at the moment. It's at the lowest valuation it has been so in 20 years. However, within the technology sector, there's a group that we call the Fat Five of the technology sector. And those are Twitter, it's Amazon, it's Yelp, it's Pandora Media, and it's Netflix. Those five stocks together are valued 700% above the current market valuation. And think about it, going back to the dot-com days, the average was only 160% above the current market valuations. So you're looking at huge valuations, a lot of optimism, a lot of hope for these stocks, and we think they will disappoint next year. So our bet is that those five stocks together will collapse by around 50%.
Peter, there are obviously some very big names there. I guess we could be looking at a new bubble in an old bubble.
Exactly. So the fascinating thing about technology stocks is, as a whole group, they were outrageously overvalued back in the dot-com days. So, but what has happened since is actually that if you look at the old technology companies like Hewlett Packard, IBM, they're actually priced now lower than the general market, so there is no premium here. But within this big technology sector, there's now a small group of players that are now valued 700% above the general market. So it really looks like there's a big bubble brewing in this small segment of the IT sector.
Is this a big worry for you, Steen?
Not really. I'm not concerned. I mean, I don't think you can be short innovation. I don't think you can be short the man's ability to innovate. But I think Peter is absolutely right, because people, as they invest, they like to have simple rules. And simple rules is you understand Amazon, you buy it. You're just ignoring the fact you're paying, what, $2,800 for every dollar they make. I mean, Bezos could be the best CEO in the world. He could be bigger in brain capacity than Einstein, but there's no way in hell he's ever going to be justifying $2,800 for every dollar he earns.
Well, can this premium continue for a long time? I mean, making this call perhaps a little premature.
Well, what I've said is actually that I think the reason why this has happened, and I think it's quite important to understand, is when we came out of the financial crisis, we had practically no growth. So when you had growth in your neighborhood, so in these small tech stocks, you're actually bidding up the growth that you can find to unreasonable levels. So I think that is what has happened. So whenever you see growth in a no growth environment, hey, you bid the prices up for these things. And now I think this this bubble has gone to such inflated levels that you could see this 50% plunge in these stocks. And we're talking about, you know, the classical names, Netflix, Amazon, Yelp, Pandora Media, Twitter. I mean, the names everyone knows, and I agree with Steen here, it's exactly what drives this. Retail investors go into the equity market and say, okay, Jesus, what do I need to buy? And they look for the names they know, and they like technology stocks because they use it on their mobile phones, they buy books on Amazon. So you get this inflation going in the stock price, and it's clearly not good for long-term returns.
Have we learned nothing from the tech bubble?
Well, I think it's you know, it's human behavior. It sort of repeats itself, and bubbles are always brewing. So I think it's just you need to be aware of this and be quite cautious, I think, in these technology stocks.
Steen, your outlook for equities, outrageous or otherwise, I suppose.
I think if any of the prior 9 calls that comes out, I think it's very likely we have a 30 to 40% correction overall. And these slightly bloated names will have a 40-50% correction. But I have to state, I think it's a huge buying opportunity if we have that kind of correction into this, hopefully, cycle of change, because we are less leveraged in the world. The current accounts are more balanced. And I think in terms of even among the politicians, which I hate to hate, and I love to hate, they are actually finally getting around to the fact that they need to do something which is based on the reality, not hope and glory.
Well, these are just some of our outrageous predictions for 2014. Can I just get a final thought from you, Steen? Because going through this process and looking at some of the arguments predicted and presented, these predictions aren't necessarily totally outrageous at all.
No, the form of has changed over 10 years. There used to be something like a revolution in Iran and the likes. But I think the we always get two kinds of people who read this, people who want them to be more outrageous and people who want them to be closer to the marketplace. So I think what we've done this year, we had a balance between what is happening next. I think the big question, this 10 outrageous prediction happens, these are all calls on what could happen in the next year instead of pretend and extend. So to some extent, it has a great theme and partly also, of course, bubbles everywhere to be seen.
Well, Steen, thank you very much. We do hope our outrageous predictions don't come true, but you never know. For more details on everything you've heard and a whole lot more, do go to TradingFloor.com, TradingFloor.com. Happy Christmas to you. We hope you have a very prosperous new year. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.